Hello everybody, Brad the Guitologist here. In today's video we have a highly unusual little piece of equipment we're going to take a look at and possibly repair and see what we can do with. This thing I found in a little antiques store, like a little out of the way standalone antiques place, and this is the kind of place you walk in, you have to squeeze around things and you have to look under things and dig, and you know, if you want to find the good stuff, that's kind of what you have to do. I actually found some pretty cool stuff at this little antique store, including a 1950s Fender pedal steel guitar, which the proprietor lady was like, just as an afterthought, you know, she's like, oh yeah, we have this old Fender guitar over here. So I ended up buying that thing and a couple other pieces as well, but this was the most unusual probably thing that I got. And this is a precise watch timer by Precise Manufacturing Company out of Springfield, Illinois. And what this appears to be is some kind of strobe device. There is a platter underneath here that spins around, and there's a light inside of it. And we'll demonstrate all this stuff later. But the light flashes and you're supposed to line it up somehow, and it produces, you send a signal through it, and you're supposed to calibrate your watches somehow with this thing. I really haven't even figured out how the hell it's supposed to work. But what we're going to do, this thing has a speaker, and it actually is a little amplifier. It has a speaker output, and it even has a schematic in here. And you can kind of see why this thing is a little bit of a weirdo. We have some selenium rectifiers in the power section. A couple of 40 microfarad capacitors, an 8 microfarad at 25 volts. It looks like we have two different secondary windings there. One is a high voltage and one is like a 6 volt. We have an input into a 12AX7. And it's hard to tell where the output's going, but let's see. Looks like it may be coming around to the second stage before it goes out of pin 6 and then through that 0001 microfarad capacitor and into pin 1 of this 2D21. Which is just an odd tube. It looks to me like it's a pentode. Coming out of that plate on pin 6. Signal should be, let's see, should be following through there. And then we've got another 6AU6 over here tied to the output transformer, which seems a little bit odd. And we have signal actually gets split off from this 12AX7 through a potentiometer, which acts as a volume, and then through this 12AU6, which is acting as an output tube with the output transformer. And the speaker is really tiny, so it doesn't need a whole lot to push it. But just a weird little thing. It's an amplifier, and then we've got this stroboscopic thing going on with this 2D21 tube. Somehow it interacts with that to create this, and I think that's the light right there. That's the neon light. It creates like a, you'll see what I mean. Here's the inside of the unit, and I've already began removing some things here. Here are selenium rectifiers, or at least two of the three. The other one is on the inside, and we'll look at it in just a bit. Here, this is a little power transformer, and I don't even see where it lists out the two secondaries. It does say it has a 6.3 volt So I don't know. I don't see the secondary. The second secondary listed there. I did find a code on one of the pots, and I think this thing's dated like 1961. It's probably a code there as well. That one has a 6 code though, so I'm not sure what that is, but this is a Viking little speaker. Tiny little speaker. I mean, this thing's probably, I don't know, 4 inches, 4-inch speaker. And then this is the motor. This is the AC motor that spins this little platter. And the little platter, I've already had to work on this little platter to get it kind of working right. When I got it, that light bulb right there was kind of dangling loose, and the platter was loose and flopping around. It was trying to spin, but it was just flopping. I've changed this 12AX7 just thinking maybe this was the problem I was getting at first. It kind of starts squealing when you first turn it on, and then you have audio for a minute, and then it just drops out. So we're going to figure out what's going on with that. But yeah, definitely a weird little unit. Let's flip this thing over and I'll show you what the guts look like. All right, here's the inside of this whole thing. The first thing I notice when I open it up is this Mallory Plas cap. This is a weird capacitor. This is 31 microfarad at 1600 volts. And that really doesn't look like something that would be 31 microfarad. First of all, it's a weird, just a really weird value, 31 microfarads. Secondly, 1600 volts, that's a really high power rating. Just a strange little cap. I'm not sure if I could even find a direct replacement for something like that. I think the 1600 volts is way over-specced. I mean, this unit shouldn't see anything like that at any point in it. Little Aerovox, we got some pyramids, a couple of those. But I think what I'm going to have to do here, I mean, this one can probably stay, this Aerovox. This one I'm going to let stay for the moment. This one's actually going to ground, so that's some kind of, I don't know what that is, but I think these work together. And since they're tied to it, yeah, I think these are part of the that oscillator, that 2D21 tube, which is right here. So these have something to do with that. And all of that seems to be working. So we're going to leave that alone for a bit. And I think these are fine. I may have to replace this capacitor. I'll measure it in a bit. Measure both sides of it and see if it's leaking any DC. Other than that, like I said, that the volume just completely drops out at some point. That resistor right there looks like it's seen better days, so we'll measure that and see what's going on. We'll measure it also at full voltage and see if we're getting volts on both sides of it and if it's doing any kind of voltage drop. So yeah, that gives us some place to start. We're also gonna replace those selenium rectifiers. This one could probably stay for the moment because, again, I think this one's tied to, I think, let's see if we follow that white wire. I think this one is tied over here to, it's tied over here to this tube, that 2D21 tube. So we can let that stand for the moment. I'm not going to worry too much about that selenium rectifier, at least for now, because, again, it's part of that spinning stroboscopic thing, and we won't mess with that very much. But we are going to change the other selenium rectifiers into a couple of diodes, probably a resistor in series. Also, we will change those electrolytic capacitors and maybe this capacitor, and we'll measure both of these components right here. But let's go ahead and do that and see if we can maybe get this thing working. All right, here are the capacitors that came out of this thing. And as you can see there, the 34th week of 1961 and the 39th week of 1961 on these Sprags. As you can also see here what kind of shape they were in. You see the bubbles there. So these were way past due. We'll get some new electrolytics in here and change these out. These rectifier diodes, selenium, and yeah, hopefully we'll have some kind of working unit. We'll see what it does. Maybe it'll do something cool. Who knows? All right, I've changed electrolytic caps in this thing and changed those diodes. Removed this tube in the back because it seemed like it was causing problems. Also removed the cap that was carrying signal over to it, just for the time being. And I was able to get some signal coming through, but notice we had some terrible noise, and the speaker unfortunately is ripped. So we're gonna try to repair this cone, or barring that, see if we can find a replacement speaker. And then we'll just kind of go from there. All right, I pulled the speaker out of this little unit, and we're gonna finish this little repair. What I'm doing is using my little trick of hot glue, and just hot gluing the two little seams together. And as I've said before, the great thing about using hot glue for this kind of little speaker repair is if you make a mistake or you put too much on or just whatever, get in the wrong spot, you can always spread it around until you get it the thickness and consistency that you want it. Now that should do nicely. As soon as that dries, which it will be dry in just a couple seconds, we'll test this little bad boy out and see what it sounds like. I can't wait. All right, here's this little unit fired up. I don't know if you can see it or not, but this little guy over here is spinning away, so the motor works. Whenever you first fire it up, you get some noise. That's because there's nothing suppressing the input. As soon as you plug something in though, it should go away. And yeah, let's test this little guy out. Let's get a pick here.
Thank you.
You can see there it's overloading somewhere along the chain, so there's a little bit of blocking distortion going on. But yeah, man, there's a lot of potential here, actually. I think some refinement on this circuit, and then maybe one more other thing. You notice if I have that other tube engaged, which it is out of the circuit right now, I just have the that little 2D21 tube out of there, and it's not doing anything. And I don't have any voltage. I've actually disconnected the voltage going to that tube socket, so there's nothing going on as far as that circuit's concerned. That's why we don't have any light lighting up in here. There should be a light flickering, strobing. But the fact that we have a light that is strobing, and we have an oscillator, and we can control the frequency of that light, are you thinking kind of what I'm thinking as far as that goes? I'm thinking we could have ourselves a little... tremolo circuit, possibly, in addition to the little amplifier. So we'll see what we can do with this thing, man. Refine it down. Actually voice this thing for guitar, because this little speaker's tiny. And this output, we have an output as well, meaning that we could probably use this thing as a little, basically... a little distortion box or preamp for guitar. So that would be cool. We could come out of this and go to a bigger amp. So we might try that as well. But let's see. Let's experiment with the idea maybe of incorporating a tremolo into this and see where that gets us. All right, we're back with this thing. And first things first, we're going to try to mitigate some of the problems that we saw in the tone. And the input, I think, is a problem. As you can see, we're going directly from the input over to the grid of the first stage. There's no grid-stopping resistor there at all. Someone has added this resistor, I guess, in an attempt to properly attenuate this input, but they didn't succeed, really, I don't think, because it's still just getting some kind of blocking distortion or something, and it's really not right for guitar. It might be right for whatever this thing was used for originally, which was watch timing or whatever. Might be perfect for that, but it's just not working for guitar. So we're gonna attenuate this input with probably like maybe a 47k or 68k resistor, grid stopping resistor. We may not do anything on the second stage of this 12AX7, but after it goes out of this stage and through the volume, it comes back to the output here. And what we might do here is another grid stopping resistor, just to ensure we're not getting any blocking distortion into this tube. And I don't see any, I don't see any reason why we shouldn't be able to do that and make that tone improve that way. We may also come in here and rebias a couple of these stages, just change the bias, or maybe even add, bypass capacitors as we see fit. Bypass capacitors are really going to be they'd have to be really low value since we have a really tiny speaker. But then again, if we use the output into another amplifier, that may help us shape the tone that we desire. One other thing I noticed is that we're getting real high, we're getting a real kind of high voltage on this second stage plate. Here's our plate resistor here. So we may, and it's actually coming off back here instead of at this point. This is our plate resistor for the first stage after this. We may experiment with moving this over to here so that we're going through this resistor first and then split off into these two and see if that doesn't help a little bit also. Like I said, we're getting really just really high voltage here. I think it was something on the order of 300 volts right there in that second stage. So yeah, we need to do something, I believe, to help with that. So let's maybe do that change. This input resistor, maybe a grid stopper here. This is off at the moment because this is what's carrying the signal over to this tube, which is currently the strobe light. But we are going to, I think what we're going to do here is try to make this into a tremolo. That will be secondary. First, let's fix the tone, and then we can come back and do this tremolo sort of secondarily. All right, yeah, the cool thing about a project like this, you really don't have to worry too much about, you know, preserving the value of it or anything like that, I don't believe. Although I did see one of these on, what was it? I guess it was on eBay. The guy wanted like $520 for the thing. Which I think is just ridiculous. Unless there are, I don't know, maybe there's a watch collector out there who would pay $520 for this thing, but I can't see it happening. But at any rate, we're going to modify this so that we have a quarter inch input instead of this thing. So in order to do that, we need to bust this old RCA jack out. All right, yeah, before you say anything, I realize this is, it looks like a total mess right now. And to the guy the other day who commented on one of my videos and said, I know you're not a very good tech because of the way your desk looks. Well, behold. Here you go, man. Awesome. Anyway, this is a decade box. What we're doing right now is we're going to bias the first stage, this first 12AX7 stage. I have the input changed to a quarter inch. We have placed a 47K resistor grid stopper on that first stage. This other resistor was measured out at about 1.2 meg, so we kept it to ground. And let's see, right now we have this set on, and this is the first stage coming off the cathode. We have this set on 1.5K. I guess I could turn this up this way so you can actually see it. But yeah, what we're going to do essentially, let me see, I'll actually turn this amp on back here too. I'm running this to my KBA-15, you know, my badass custom KBA-15 amplifier. That's essentially just my little desk test amp. It's coming out the output. Very trebly at the moment, very, very trebly. We could probably express a little more bass by changing some of these cap values. And also we're gonna add a bypass cap, and that's what this is all about. And we'll test out a couple of those as well. But right now we're just kind of trying to get this first stage of the 12AX7 sort of dialed in on the bias. And this KBA-15 amplifier, it is seriously, it's just a clean amp only. It's like a bass amp. Right now it's very noisy, but I'm under a light, so that accounts for a lot of the noise. Also, this is not a grounded plug that's on this thing, so putting a grounded plug on it, getting it out from under the fluorescent light will help a lot with the noise. I've noticed already, because of that grid stopping resistor right there on the input, that when I turn down my volume, I no longer get the whoosh, whoosh, whoosh sound, and I'm no longer getting blocking distortion through the amp, it seems. Now, the longer this warms up, I did notice that I could not really turn my volume up before, past about halfway for some reason, and I'm suspecting maybe this cap that's going through the volume pot and then back out to the output stage. I'm thinking maybe that cap right there could be bad under heat. So we're gonna kind of test that theory, and here in a little bit I'll put my leads on the volume pot and test it for leaked voltage, which it may very well have. I don't know, and that might be why it's kind of crapping out after a while. That's my theory anyway. Don't hold me to it. Right now, man, that's really, it's really ice picky, really tinny. If you wanted something that would cut through a mix, this would definitely do that. But I think we're gonna try to warm it up a little bit, and let's go through and change some of these other values. All right, what we're doing now is we're trying some bypass capacitors on this first stage as well, just going from the cathode to ground, in parallel with our bias resistor. The first selection here is a 25 microfarad. And I don't know if you can hear this on the video or not, but I've cranked this up and you can listen to the little hissing that's going on there. And as soon as I connect this bypass cap, as soon as I connect this wire here, you'll listen to the difference in the hiss. So yeah, it's actually cut off some of that hiss, or at least suppressed it. And it's no longer nearly as ice picky either. I'll play the same series of chords with and without that bypass cap. Okay, now here it is without it. Admittedly, I can't tell a huge difference, but where I can tell a difference is in the amount of noise, it seems. And I don't know if that might have actually something to do with these wires also that are running all around. But there's definitely a little bit more low end, I think, too, just a smidgen. Now without. I think I actually like it slightly better without that bypass cap. So what we might do is select a very low value bypass cap. We'll just kind of go down from this point. I know that I like, I like it without a bypass cap slightly better than with this. So if we go down from this value and just kind of step our way down, eventually we'll come across the, you know, kind of the Goldilocks point where it's just right. All right, I have rebiased both of the stages of that 12AX7 tube and used a 1000 and a 1500 ohm resistor respectively. The biggest problem though, I think, with the tinniness of this preamp is with the interstage capacitors. You'll see here both of those right there, both of those capacitors are 0.0001. That is a 100 picofarad. So that's really small for a coupling capacitor. And also the capacitor between these two stages, I believe that's the one right there. Yeah, coming off the plate. That's a 0015, which is small in and of itself, but nothing near as small as those. So I think that one might actually be okay, that 0.001 right there. I'm going to focus my attention, however, on this 100 picofarad right before that pot. So we will experiment with different capacitors in that position, and we may also experiment with different bypass capacitors on this second stage over here, this stage right here coming off of pin 8 basically. That's the one with the 1500 ohm resistor that I just added. And what we will do probably is try to bypass that with a capacitor. And because we will have changed this to a larger value, it will have a more pronounced effect. So we're gonna experiment with those two things. Upping that value right there of that 100 pico, and also adding on pin 8 right there, adding a bypass capacitor along with the bias resistor that we've already added. All right, here's an opportunity to show you a little trick. This insulation is being a little bit stubborn, and rather than use my stripper and risk you know, ripping this or breaking this little pin off down here, because they're kind of fragile. I've actually already broken one of the other pins off and had to work around that. So I don't want to break this pin off because it has a lot of connections on it. So the best way to not apply pressure when you're trying to strip a wire like this and avoid breaking other things off down where it's connected is to get your needle nose and put under here like this and just hold your needle nose. And then you've got some leverage where all you have to do is twist your wire stripper then. So you just twist this, and then you have leverage against here, and you're putting no pressure behind it. So that's a nice little tip. All right, now we're going to experiment with the capacitor between the second 12AX7 stage and that output stage. So first we're gonna start out with this capacitor decade box on the original 100 picofarad setting. All right, so here's 100 picofarad. Pretty tinny. Let's go, bump up to 220 pico. A little bit less tinny. Here is 500 pico. Considerably less tinny. Let's bump up to 001. .015, this is the same capacitor value that is in the between the first two stages. Still some tinniness there, but nice cut, nice with a Telecaster. Here's a 0022. Thank you. let's bump up onto something more like a little closer to what we're used to, like 0.01. At this point, I've gotten this thing sounding pretty much absolutely amazing, especially for what it is. But this is a problem that you'll sometimes encounter when you're messing around with equipment like this. And let's see the safest way to do this. Tell you what, I'll just I'll unplug this one. Okay, now this is a good way to demonstrate it on the input. Right there, if this was shielded from this light above, it would be pretty quiet. But if I remove this little component right here, listen to this. Okay, what that is, that's some high frequency oscillations because there's so much gain in this circuit. Without suppressing some of those high frequencies, you're going to get that sort of squealing. I'll show you once more, just for good measure. Because you know you like that sound. Sounds like a banshee screaming or something. This is something that can happen in any high gain amplifier. And what I'm basically doing is I'm inserting a 0.001 capacitor from the plate of the first stage to ground, and that's suppressing all those highs. I could experiment with this value, but the reason I even chose this value to begin with is because I think this value was used in some Supro amplifiers in that very position. So I don't know. I just kind of took a guess and thought maybe that would suppress them, and it is. And I will actually refine that probably and try maybe, I don't know, maybe try a 0.002, but I don't think it's going to get us any better off. We might actually be detrimental to the tone at that point. But anyway, that's, you know, something that you can do if you're getting a lot of high-pitched squeal on one of your designs. Try sticking like a 0.001 capacitor from your first stage plate to ground. Something else I want to demonstrate really quickly while I have this thing out and while it's on. You can see this mechanism inside of there spinning around, and that's basically just a motor on the back that's spinning this plate. And there is a light attached to part of the plate, and if you dial this control right here, you can affect the frequency at which that light blinks, and you'll see it's blinking in different positions every time. The more I increase this, you'll see how it's kind of blinking around and around. Let me turn some of these lights off. Hang on. And you can actually get it to stop. Kind of like a stroboscopic effect. When you're trying to dial in, for instance, the speed of a turntable, if it has those strobe indicators along the sides of the turntable. This is kind of the same sort of concept. I'm not exactly sure even how they would use this to time watches. I'm not even sure what they would do. Probably has something to do with the frequency, the known frequency of the spinning, and comparing that to a known frequency of one of the cogs or something. I don't know. But you see here, you can really get it to kind of do some wild stuff. But the beauty of it is that flashing light right there. I wanted to demonstrate how it works because, we're basically going to remove that circuit more or less, or we're going to modify it heavily probably. And what we're going to do is, since we have a flashing light and we have a way to control the rate of the flash, obviously we have a way to control a tremolo circuit. So what we're going to do is see if we can design a simple tremolo circuit using the flashing light and a photoresistor, and we'll insert the photoresistor leads somewhere into the signal path to see if we can affect a tremolo effect. So stick around for that. All right, that's probably about all we'll have time for in this episode. Stay tuned for part two, where we will design a tremolo circuit for this thing and also test out the tone. So until then, see you guys later. If you haven't done so already, hit the subscribe button below so that you can get future updates, including the part two to this video. And for now, y'all take care.